Ann Marchin. I'm at Shenandoah University in the beautiful Shenandoah Valley in Virginia. And I'm the director for the Center for Teaching and Learning there, or the co-director, I should say. And I'm also the director for Transformative Teaching and Learning, which means just simply it's a code word for I wear lots of hats. This is the kind of topic where I think it will be richer if we all participate. Certainly I will benefit. So I invite you to jump in at any time, interrupt me, you know, whatever, because I think all ideas are we need all the good ideas that we can find on these topics. I'm stating the obvious here. Our society is very polarized, right? We see this every day. And this, as somebody in the Center for Teaching and Learning, this got me thinking. So what habits of mind are we teaching that are contributing to this? Are we part of the problem or are we part of the solution? And that's even by itself a polarizing comment. But what can we be doing better? What can we do to reduce polarization so that as a society we can function well, we can solve problems, and we can get along? And so I started thinking about polarizing activities. And then I realized that there are a lot of them, and I am very guilty of many of these. Having students do debates, pro or con, identify true or false, agree or disagree, challenge response, plot X versus Y, and probably you can think of some other things. And I'm not saying these things are necessarily bad, that they don't have their place, but maybe we need to balance a little bit with some other kinds of things so we get to nuances, we get to more critical thinking, more critical evaluation, and beyond that, the next step, which is to build. So when I start thinking about what do we do? And I realize we have a challenge, because especially freshmen, sophomores, who by the nature of their age, usually not necessarily, may not have tremendous life experiences, we may need to help them transition from a knee-jerk reaction to a place where they can value perspectives from one another, realize that when you have multiple perspectives and you take those into account and you really listen to one another, that you strengthen the community or the team or whatever the group is. How do we get them there? And there's been a lot written about this lately. There's been a lot of discussions about this. And I hope that we'll have a good discussion about this here, too. Also part of the backdrop, about a year ago, and I want to say for the record that this is before the election, we embarked on a mission, really, to do intercultural understanding at Shenandoah University. And this was sui generis. It was an ad hoc, nobody told us to do this, okay? A group came together, disturbed by events in the community. There was one particularly disturbing event on campus, not consistent with Shenandoah values at all. You know, we are always a very inclusive environment where we celebrate our diversity. And I have to give credit to my staff colleagues because they really led this. They really said, you know, we need to do something. This group meets every other week, very regularly, and we've put together a number of trainings. I won't read the learning objectives to you, but you can see them here. This was a real learning process. I certainly learned a lot. We invited a whole group of guest speakers, most recently Lee Neffelkamp. I don't know if you know Lee from AACNU. She was at Shenandoah actually just earlier this week, and if you're interested, I've put the link here. And these slides, by the way, are available on the Bryn Mawr website. This is a keynote speech she gave at Tufts last year, so if you're interested in the kind of work she does. So in that process, we developed some ideas that we use, and I'll just describe a few to give you an idea of the kind of thing and how this, so you can see how this contributed to my thinking. The first was the iceberg model. Is anybody familiar with the iceberg model? Okay, a couple of you. Okay. So in with respect to culture, you know, you see some things that are on the surface that are fairly obvious. Clothing, music, food, these things are things that help us to appreciate other folks' cultures. Below the surface, though, we have differences that run much deeper. These may have to do with things like how we value and use time, how we relate to our families, how we interact with one another, our beliefs, our values, and so forth. And so this is a little concept map that we use when we start the workshop. We ask participants to describe a time when they were the other, when they were the minority, when they felt uncomfortable. So a sort of storytelling exercise. And then we have a series of genuine student responses that describe microaggressions, where we have folks work in teams to evaluate and respond what's going on in those situations. And I'm sure you folks are familiar with microaggressions, right? This is the idea that it's kind of like almost an insult. It's where someone makes a remark, often unintentional, but it can be very destructive and very painful for the person. Yeah.
Do you consult with student examples, or do you give them examples to work with?
Oh no, we give them real examples. Okay. So they did a survey, sort of baseline survey, to get examples from the students, and they're anonymous. They're presented anonymously, but these are real, genuine examples. And those work really well. And I'm having a little bit of a flashback here. I might just share with you a story because your question reminded me. A couple years after I started working at Shenandoah, a faculty member came to me very upset because on her final course evaluations, her students accused her of being racist, and she was very upset by this. And the reason was that the students were sort of self-segregating in the classroom, and she did nothing about it. And she was like, "Is this my fault?" And I tried to gently tell her that, making an uncomfortable learning environment is everybody's responsibility, and so let's learn from this. And, she was just focused. She's not a bad person. She certainly took this to heart, but she was focused on her content. A nursing professor, she was working, thinking about her content. It didn't occur. She thought, no, students stick with their one, right? So let them sit with their one. And she hadn't even thought of that. So these are the kinds of things that, the kinds of experiences that we pull together, real world examples, so that the teams can respond to this. So this generated a lot of discussion, and what we decided after running some of these workshops is that we were really good at talking about these things with like-minded people, but we were not so good at having conversations with folks that we really needed to reach to figure out how we can come together. And I am very guilty of this. When I meet somebody whose values are very different from my own, I tend to be very quiet, very polite, and respectful, and I don't engage. Okay? And we're never going to get past polarization if we don't figure this out. So, bear another story here. When I was, some years ago, when I was teaching IT ethics, we were talking about the Patriot Act. This is a long time ago. And I had a student who got really interested in it, and he came to my office, and he had a very extreme viewpoint. And he argued and argued with me, and we argued and argued. And then he came back another day, and we argued and argued and argued. But it was good, because at the end of it, we realized that we were both motivated by the same things. Values having to do with security and having to do with personal liberty. But we were coming at it from very different life experiences, very different pathways to achieve an objective. And I realize now, reflecting back on that, that I was very ill-equipped. I mean, it ended well in the sense that we got to a place where we had some sort of mutual understanding and respect, but we did not take the next step, which is to build consensus and to think about putting plank by plank in place. And I think that's really the harder challenge. All right, so these are just a lot of little things that went into my thinking, with a little bit stream of consciousness there, but I wanted to give you some of the backdrop. Now I'd like to be a little bit more focused, and I invite you at any time to any comments or questions to this point or thoughts. Yeah, please.
The one thing you said about particularly about being polite, mm-hmm. We've lost that. The special snowflake concept has taken over, and the universe rotates around all of us, right? Mm-hmm. No, it doesn't. And I mean, I don't care what the age of the person is, what their profession, what their background is. We have a society who thinks that the universe rotates around them. Mm-hmm. So that's going to breed conflict. It's my universe, no, it's yours. Okay. Mm-hmm. And if you could just back down a little bit, mm-hmm. and say, guess what? We all have our own ideas. Doesn't make them right, doesn't make them wrong. Mm-hmm. But like yielding on the highway, anyone's got to get first.
Yeah.
Because they got to text faster than somebody else, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Back down just a little bit. Let's not be so ultra. offended by everything, or, you know, it's mine. No. Mm-hmm. But, you know, a little bit of politeness wouldn't hurt the society. And I mean Congress, I mean Washington, I mean all the CEOs, I mean the whole shooting match.
Mm-hmm. No, I appreciate that point of view. Because you're absolutely right. If you go to a small town,
right,
and you experience how people are much more courteous to each other versus a
yes.
big city where there's a lot of this stuff, you know, and people cutting each other, blowing horns and all kinds of stuff. It's a really different experience.
I guess I think it goes way beyond an electoral bounds. It goes way beyond that.
Right. No, that's very interesting. I used to, when I was teaching IT ethics, we used to talk about that particular thing, and I used to give the example of, you know, if I'm carrying a big load of books and stuff, and I get to the door, someone will open the door for me. But when we're merging onto the freeway,
yes.
you better believe they're going to cut me off, right? So why do we behave differently?
Right.
Yeah, it's interesting. So anyway, I want to get to how we teach some of these ideas, because I think this is the challenge, and I want to call on, your creativity and ingenuity here as well. I think sometimes when we're teaching online in particular, using learning management tools, like a discussion board or a blog, that these things are a little bit sterile, and so we need to not just look at the screen in front of us, but just engage our imaginations to find other ways of doing things that may be more, that may be richer. Is anybody familiar with this one, the yes and improv thing? There's been a lot of discussion on it in the pod listserv. Does anybody here belong to pod? Yeah, a couple folks. This is a group of people who do teaching and learning and share a lot of instructional technology and teaching strategy ideas. This is the idea that if you get a class discussion going, you present them with a problem or an issue to discuss, they can't say no and just disagree. They have to build on what the last person said by starting with yes and. So they have to think about what was right or what was at least valuable in what the last person said and sort of think about their perspective before going on. So it's an exercise sort of in building consensus and also I think in listening, getting people to really appreciate other people's points of view. You can make it kind of a game. You can make it kind of light, and it turns out to be kind of fun if you give this a try. So, can you think about how you might implement this in an online lesson? Any thoughts? How might it work?
I was just in another session about using an annotation tool called Hypothesis, and I can imagine that the assignment would be not just to post an annotation of your own, but also to add to and respond to another student's annotation that already exists there.
Absolutely, yes, and Hypothesis is great for that. Yeah. Any thoughts? It could be as simple as using a discussion board. Folks who are here use Canvas. I love, one of the things I really love about Canvas is you can click that little box that requires the student to post before they can see the other student's posts. So they have to do the thinking themselves before they can do their own. Yeah, here's another one. So define an issue or a problem and have students work in teams to, instead of just tackle the problem, identify a team to solve the problem. What would this team look like? Who would these participants be? What skills do they need? What resources do they need to solve the problem? And then once they have that, use Google Docs or some other tool to create an agenda for the first team meeting. And then come up with strategies for reaching consensus so that they work together in a functional way rather than having the dominant personalities polarize the conversation. How do they make sure that they work together in a functional fashion? And I thought at this juncture, this was...
Do you think students always understand what it means to reach consensus?
Yeah, that's a really great point. How would you define it? I don't know.
I think I have experienced it from working in workplaces where the group has to reach consensus before you can work move forward. And for a lot of people, they tend to think it means just giving in so we can just move forward. Whereas guys, what is, like, you know, talking about what is true consensus, and it, you know, I'm wondering if people build in conversations about, like, what are we talking about? What does that look like? And how do people, you know, how do you know when you haven't gotten it? How do you know if someone's just like, okay, it's fine, let's move on, and it's not fine? You know, like, they're giving in to go on, but it's something that's important. So I'm just wondering, is that built into some of the things that you do, and do you sense that students or participants always understand what consensus means?
You know, I don't, and I need to, because I think that's a great point. I think that's, in fact, I'm going to take some notes after this, because I think that's really a great idea. Getting folks to understand that to really have consensus in a solid team, all voices have to be heard, and everybody doesn't have to absolutely agree about everything, but everybody needs to be at a place where they, you know, you sort of have buy-in, but it's not just giving in, as you say. So.
Sometimes in some groups it ends up being the last person standing.
Yeah.
Whoever argued the longest and the hardest.
Right. Right. We hate that.
Yeah.
Well, I've been, like, going on with that. The other thing about, like, consensus is it has to be, like, if something's important to me, I'm going to care whether that outcome is something that I can live with. But if it's not important to me, I just want to move on, you know? So I think it has to be, like, consensus isn't going to be meaningful unless the thing that you're consenting around is important.
Mm-hmm. And we see that with students, right? They have to understand the relevance. It has to be important to them, or they just sit there like lumps, right?
But I was thinking, like, if you go back to the previous slide.
Yes.
So it's like define an issue or a problem. I was thinking about that. I mean, I think a lot of that is, like, what that actually means in practice, because who's defining the issue and the problem, and how is the issue or the problem relevant to the particular course?
Mm-hmm. Well, you absolutely, and that is something that the instructor, I was trying to define this in a way that it was, you know, relevant to, you know, to any particular discipline, but you're absolutely right. You've got to make it relevant so it's not too abstract.
Well, so, again, like, I think it's who's defining the issue or the problem, because like every discipline is going to have issues or problems, but I think it's important that, like, if you're going to do this, that the issue or problem is one that resonates with that particular course.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely right.
I mean, building on actually both your comment and your comment, one of the things, so I teach physics, right, and so it's slightly different in terms of the types of issues that we deal with, but I do have a question where at the beginning, particularly in our advanced lab course, I asked students, what is your definition of a successful experiment? And what is your definition of a successful group? And then in this course, you are going to be working for 10 weeks with a group on an extended experiment. And how do your definitions of a successful experiment and a successful group intersect? Because indeed, sometimes, right, when they come up for a successful experiment is, you know, we want to, you know, have something that works well, that gives us clean data, blah, 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 right? And sometimes their definition of successful is something where, you know, I learned something new that I haven't learned before, right? And so then they're sitting in a group, and group members may have definitions of what a different successful experiment is. And also, similarly, if they have their definitions of what a successful group is, some people say a successful group is one where, you know, we all get what needs to be done as efficiently as possible, right? And some people will respond, my definition of a successful group is one where everyone feels like they're contributing in a positive manner to the group. And so it's interesting in that activity because you both identify, you get to see sort of what the group sees as, you know, what their goal is, right? And you see where their goals are consistent or inconsistent. And then you also get to see, like, to this question of, like, what is consensus? We don't ask particularly about what is consensus, but, like, what do they see as a successful group functioning or not? And then looking at those intersections of the two, I find has been really valuable in sort of trying to sort out some of these differences.
And that's a great segue to exactly what I wanted to talk about next, which is how do we have groups that work together successfully? When I teach a non-credit certificate course on distance and hybrid teaching, and invariably when we get to the point where we talk about group work, which is huge for distance education, I mean, it's a great way to develop learning communities and get to deep learning. So I'm a big believer in teamwork and collaborative learning, but I invariably I'll have one or two faculty who say, I used to do it, and I gave up because I got tired of playing marriage counselor. And the strong students complained that the weak students aren't doing their work, and it was unpleasant, and it wasn't working, so I just gave up. And so I tried gently to say, well, can we revisit this? Because, you know, this is a moment to teach here. You know, because in the real world, you're that newbie, you don't always get to pick the people you work with, and you can't always work by yourself, so, you know, we have to get along in this world. So helping the stronger students realize that when the weaker students are not engaging, it's usually not because they're not motivated and they don't care. It's usually because they don't know how. They don't know what to do. They don't know how to get started. They have questions. They are insecure. And so it's easier to step back. And so helping those, you know, type A, more assertive students to realize that what's needed is some dialogue to, and I think the comments that you just made about what does a successful group look like, and having the students define it themselves can be very helpful there. Getting them, setting the expectation that if not everybody's participating equally, the team is not succeeding. And giving them some skills that are not, may not obvious to them, like having regular team meetings, setting an agenda, and making sure that at the end of each meeting, everyone knows what their job is and how to get help when they need it, and everyone's comfortable with the next steps. Any other thoughts? Are there strategies? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, kind of going off of everything that's been talked about. I think I found out, and one thing that's helpful for me is because I work on a team of like 3 to 4 people pretty closely. We have a lot of group activities and independent work on a case-by-case basis. And we talked a lot about like how to manage the fact that we all not only like have different personalities, but we have different approaches to work. Which I think, yes, people are more assertive and want to just like get done. Some people are more accommodating and like want to make sure people like feel engaged and like they're contributing. Like that's a real thing they care about. And I feel like one of the issues that can happen is like if you can't have a conversation with everyone, you have to work within a group. Some people aren't going to talk. They could have really good ideas, and you're not going to hear them because the other perspective gets kind of like becomes the dominant one. And I like to think that everyone has a pretty good perspective. It doesn't always get heard if you're not having an open dialogue. So I think like for us, we actually went to a workshop where we had to go through all this, which like in this situation, like how would you approach like this confrontation? And we filled it out and we found out like where we fell and like some of us were more accommodating, some of us were more assertive, and like knowing that about each other was like, oh my god, no wonder you react to the situation a certain way. So I think like in a way just like being able to kind of talk about your kind of work ethic along with your colleagues, your group you're working with can actually help a lot with that, because then you'll know like, oh well, they tend to like, you know, care more about this, like let's make sure we engage with that if we have a group project and we want to make sure we do a good job. It's like a collaboration, like people seem to like be really afraid of that word, but like a collaboration in itself should be a sum of everything everyone is good at doing to make something better than you can do yourself. Like you need everyone's good ideas to make something better than you can think of with just your one idea. So,
and it's a very insightful comment. And years ago when I was teaching project management, we did a little Myers-Briggs, a modified Myers-Briggs, to help students with just that point, you know, to give them insights so they realize that when other people are not moving as fast as they are, it's because
it's a different approach. That's all it is.
It's not
but
it's no less valuable,
it's just
right?
Different.
It's more, you know, reflective or whatever, but that people do approach their work differently. So. Okay. So this next one is my personal favorite, and I'll see what you think about it. I attended the CIDR conference at Virginia Tech in February, a great conference, by the way, and I saw these two workshops back-to-back. One was on intercultural understanding, and the other one was on the QSORT, and I said, in my head, I glued them together. QSORT is a test of subjectivity. Some of you may know of this from the world of statistics. The idea here is that you rank things as to whether or not they are true or false. So instead of perhaps giving a student a multiple choice question and say which one is right, you might give them 4 very provocative statements and ask them to evaluate them, rank them, as to whether or not they are more or less true. It is annoying when people don't speak English. Immigrants should adapt to American culture. Everyone has an equal chance in American society. And these are real examples from the other workshop I attended. And there are significant social and economic barriers based on ethnocultural background. Now, if you were asked to just simply identify which one is true or most true, you might instantly, with some justification, leap to one of these, right? But if you were, and not think about it very deeply, but if you were asked to rank these as to which is more or less true, am I right? You have to think about it a little bit more carefully. So I think this can be valuable. This is sort of an extreme example, perhaps, but I think you could envision, perhaps, a discussion board exercise in which you give students a provocative statement or series of statements and ask them to rank them. You get a lot of thinking from them, a lot of analysis. You get something that's easy to grade, yay, something for easiest us to evaluate. But a lot of thinking has to go on about it. But you have to think a little bit more deeply. Yes, yes.
So just kind of as a technical question with that framing in a discussion board, it would be that each student sees the other student's responses as opposed to like a choice, you know, using Moodle, like a kind of a ranking where you could see it and then post the ranks to the class. What you're saying is you'd see each student's kind of thinking through this process and each student would see each other's.
What I might be tempted to do is to actually require them to post first before they could see the others.
Mm-hmm.
But then perhaps I might give them extra points if they respond to each other, too. I mean, there are lots of ways you can frame it. So I think it could be managed in a couple of different ways. But I would certainly want to force them to think it through themselves before analyzing it. Yes, please.
So how do you do when some students have a lot lower stakes than others? So like, for instance, a white American student answering this, and I don't know, a person of color who's not American. Like, how do you put those two? Because it's a lot easier to talk about something when it's not personally important to you, when it doesn't affect you. So how do you break that bias or make sure that the people you're talking about feel comfortable being talked about?
That is a really great question, because it gets to the heart of exactly what we're trying to do, which is to create an environment in which everyone is comfortable and feeling like the conversation is moving us all forward. And you know, I think you have to, as the instructor, set those ground rules. You know, you have to make sure that there's mutual respect and that everyone. You know, there are times where if you're not comfortable, that's okay, and you don't have to, you know, you don't require people to engage at a level in which they're more comfortable. And this is, as you, I'm sure you're aware, this is a topic that's been, the talk about microaggressions and that kind of thing. People have very different viewpoints on whether or not these things should be discussed and how they are discussed. But this is our challenge, which is to find ways to bridge those gaps. And I think one of the things that really helps is when you do things like the exercise where you ask everybody to find a time when they were the other, where they were not, when they did not feel comfortable, and to identify that so that you establish an atmosphere of empathy to begin with, so that people aren't walking into a room feeling like I'm an outsider. Everybody else is something else. You have to help people realize that even in a group where most of the people look the same, there are lots of different cultures going on there. And when you can get it down to that level, then people begin. But it's an excellent question, and I don't pretend to have all the answers. I think it's one we all have to work on. This is another one that's been talked about a lot, context-rich questions. It's sort of a spin on problem-solving, problem-based learning. And this is the idea that you give groups a problem to solve. It comes from University of Minnesota Physics. And you give the students a lot of information, but maybe not everything they need to solve the problem. And you give them some information that they don't need to solve the problem. So their job is to sort out what they need, what they don't need, and what the next steps are themselves. What do they need to go out and find? And this is just another way to I don't know if you have this experience where you come into the classroom and you start talking to students, and they're just, don't give me the details, just tell me what I need to do. You have this? And you go, no, you're missing the point. We all need to learn how to solve problems. So I think this kind of thing can be helpful. And you may be familiar with the so-called jigsaw discussion, where you divide students into groups, but you have each one take a part of a problem, or each group take a part of a problem. Here's an example from environmental conservation, which is a topic near and dear to my heart. The American wood turtle is a threatened species. You might have one team dealing with habitat loss, another one with illegal collection, another with predation, another with roadkills. Identifying and analyzing the different threats, and then have each team present their findings to the class as a whole, and then as a class constructing a species survival plan. So the value here is that, again, students have to listen to each other, they have to think deeply about what other people are presenting. They can't just take ownership of their own part and then just back away if they're going to be successful. If the whole class is going to be successful, then they have to realize that even if that they have to take some ownership of the whole project, not just their piece. So, just a thought, yeah.
In the last example, in particular, made me think of actually a teacher that I had once gave us all group projects. We got a packet of information, and it was kind of like a simulation. But what we didn't know, and so we all had a group of four or five people, but what we didn't know was that all of our information wasn't the same. She didn't tell us up front, so it's kind of like a murder mystery.
Uh-huh.
You know, but like when you do a murder mystery, you know what's going on. So it slowly came out as people were realizing, well, where did you find that? You're rifling through your packets, and then you have to like piece together. And it was funny how it kind of organically came out that the information I have is something that you need in order to get, you know, and I thought that was, one, clever,
yeah.
But also very, you know, much more in line with kind of real world scenarios when you have no idea what somebody else's background and expertise is, and you kind of have to tease those out through group work, so.
I love that.
It was very interesting, and actually it's stuck with me a very long time.
Yeah, I love that. I'm going to try that. That sounds like a lot of fun. And a great way to develop active listening, you know. As you say, people have to really pay attention to what other people are contributing. Oh, I think that's really fun. It's got to be a lot of work put together, but I bet it'd be really worth it.
Yeah, and I think part of, afterwards, I don't know how she kept, like, a straight face, like, as listening to different groups, realizing, like, trying to figure out what's going on and solve the issue, but, talking about it afterwards with, being able to do that self-reflection on, like, that moment everybody realized, what was going on, or how to get it, how it clicked, and that also was, I think, incredibly powerful.
And it stayed with you. Right, so that tells you it was a very powerful learning activity.
Well, that's great. And it's just I wanted to give us something that was sort of non-discussion based or something a little bit quantitative.
There are a lot of great tools now for creating visualizations of various kinds that are not just two-dimensional. You can use Google, you can use Plotly, Deduce, even Excel. This is a chart that was created by a Google tool. In fact, it's just copied and pasted from their website. That's charting life expectancy, fertility, and population of some countries. So you can see the different sizes of the circles contributes to the information being displayed. So instead of just X, Y, encouraging some more three-dimensional nuanced thinking.
All right, so what I thought we could do next is to work in pairs, person that's sitting next to you, or on small groups, as you prefer. And let's take a few minutes, and we'll see, I just arbitrarily picked 20 minutes, but we can see how much time you'd like, to think about an assignment that you use in your class, and maybe it's a class, face-to-face class, and you want to adapt it to online, or maybe it's something you're already doing online, and think about how you would deploy it, and how you would assess it, and again, the objective here is to come up with something that encourages multiple perspective taking, deep analysis, and then let's share our views. Each team, maybe just a little summary of the kinds of things you talked about, if you folks want to start us off.
Can you go back to the instruction you gave us for a second?
Sure.
We were both surprised that that this was meant to be sort of like an online lesson.
Mm-hmm.
Neither one of us has experience in teaching only online learning, and so we didn't talk about doing this in an online environment. We talked mostly about what we've done in our face-to-face classes trying to come up with ways to build empathy, to help see the world through a different person's eyes, and sometimes using technology to do that. Lenny had we were describing.
Well, I was saying how I used Google Docs, but not signing into their own Google Docs, but the anonymous Google Doc. So after the elections, we did that. And then I didn't mention it, but we had a video that, it's like a blackface video that was posted and went viral at Albright. So that was another instance where we were able to, discuss that anonymously. But because it was on the World Wide Web, they knew that it's still, they were still discussing with other students from the class, so they weren't disrespectful. So that was the
which surprised me, because whenever I've thought about anonymous, about controversial issues, on my campus, these anonymous yik yak things or whatever pop up, and people just trash each other. But this is an interesting example of, you thought that people were able to have conversations respectfully that they weren't having face to face because of an anonymous in class setting.
I like that. Yeah, I agree. I normally would associate anonymity with people, doing bad things and being cowardly and using it as a way to hide. But I like this because it goes to what this gentleman was saying about, some people not being comfortable, participating. But this kind of helps to create a safe zone where people can be, a little bit more objective because they can look at it from a distance a little bit. So, yeah.
As opposed to just, the internet and the anonymity there where you can say whatever you want. I mean, when you're doing it via an LMS discussion, like teachers watching,
mm-hmm.
and so I think there is a little bit of, students are more in tune with knowing the repercussions of what they write.
And helping them understand that, on the internet, you're establishing, no one is ever truly anonymous. There's always the online reputation thing, too, so there's that angle of it. So. What kind of thing did you work on in your group?
Well, we kind of started about your program, the Bridge program.
I was talking about how we had tried something where we did an online bridge program for incoming students,
mm-hmm.
and we thought that was a little bit the challenge there of, usually bridge programs are wanting to create community,
mm-hmm.
right? And yet, because it was online, we were talking about sort of the challenges of what are the ways you can get people who are interacting online to feel like they're getting connected, but we also talked about, so we decided that there are some challenges with that, but we also decided there are some benefits because people aren't coming in and seeing, this is the person who, looks like this type of person I'd be friends with, or this is the person who's wearing the designer clothing, and so it actually does lower the barriers you don't know the people, but some of the sort of visual snap judgments that you make are removed when your first interactions with people are just meeting them in an online setting.
I would love to talk to you about that because we're talking about a summer bridge too, and we're thinking about exactly those issues. Okay, how about this group?
We talked about how at Philadelphia in high school we're implementing the blended learning model in a lot of the high schools. So that requires a lot more collaboration, and it's a huge shift from the traditional instruction of talk, and then really requiring teachers to set up classrooms that are more interactive. So, I spoke to my partner here about using a resource called Newsela. And Newsela is an online resource where you can just get up-to-date, current informational text. And so teachers, can get alerts, and they get the information, and they can share it with the students. And what they are asked to do is engage in Socratic seminar. So once they engage in the Socratic Center. So what I was talking about was that the fact that we made a lot of assumptions in the beginning that people understood what empathy was and that mm-hmm. people understood what coming to consensus is about. And so we had to kind of, you know, backtrack and do some real explicit conversations and discussions with teachers about how to roll that out. But one example was that a teacher had an article about a student who came to class with a Confederate flag t-shirt mm-hmm. on. And so it really sparked great discussion because we're dealing with apathetic high schoolers and, you know, they can care about this stuff. But, you know, it really engaged the class in discussion. And although most of the students looked the same, there were many cultures represented in that classroom. And the teacher's perspective when I did the post-conference with him was he didn't think it was a successful lesson. And he didn't think it was successful because people were really, you know, going back and forth. And, you know, and so that's just, you know, another phase of understanding that, no, it wasn't a successful conversation, I mean, a successful lesson, because it brought the student engagement level up. And we can, of course, manage a little bit more by instituting more, you know, the norms before we start and all that sort of thing. But it was definitely, New Skill is something that it's a great online resource if you want to use it.
I'll check that one out. And you're absolutely right. Sometimes the best teaching is a little messy, but
yes.
It doesn't have to be, you know, perfectly controlled and orchestrated to be great teaching. Sometimes when it's a little bit messy and chaotic, that can be the best.
I think that's more human learning. We've had plenty of programming in
mm-hmm.
society. I mean, all, like I said, across the board.
Mm-hmm.
All languages.
Yeah.
I like, it's more spontaneous, it's more, you get that interaction.
Then you remember it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay, how about this team?
Okay, we were toggling between several different things,
mm-hmm.
and we kind of got hung up on the number three aspect of how to assess, and
mm-hmm.
I was trying to tie in my subject matter with what we were coming up with, and as far as collaborative dealing with language, one of the activities that I do face-to-face is they get a new set of verbs, for example.
Mm-hmm.
They form sentences according to who in the group does that particular activity and who doesn't. And each student has different verbs. So at the end, they report on what they found.
Mm-hmm.
How are we going to tie that to their community? And
mm-hmm.
Like if the verb means to dance, how can we tie that to who, what
mm-hmm.
dancers they know? And like, well, they can't deal with that really in the language at the elementary level. But if we're going to go deeper, I'm thinking culturally based teaching. When I end my second course, I show two classical movements. One deals mostly with traditional versus non-traditional learning. And if we could possibly show the movie and have them have a collaborative discussion on traditional versus non-traditional, how they learn. And also tied in with that, this particular movie is based on Latin American students
mm-hmm.
and similarities between those students and my students who are predominantly African American, challenges that they face
mm-hmm.
and that sort of thing. So just a discussion on that, what they could find out, how they form their opinions and what they're basing it on and tying in different scenarios from the movies and
so forming empathy by forcing them to think through how they make those judgments.
Right.
Very nice.
That's kind of where we were going.
Uh-huh.
If I could piggyback on that, there's a program in Philadelphia where they take the students and elementary, middle, and high school students, and they involve them in ballroom dancing. There's a ballroom dance program. So,
uh-huh.
you know, you spoke about dance, and I was
right.
thinking, wow, that'd be great.
Uh-huh.
You know, because they get to really see it, and they, you know, get to kind of match it or
mm-hmm.
see how it, you know, just a different perspective of what dance really is,
right.
know, could be. So and then,
right.
you know, they get to talk about it, and they meet students from outside of the city
uh-huh.
who are also in the ballroom dancing program, and
right.
it's excellent. So I went to their, you know, their ballroom dancing competition, and so it's really great because, you know, now we have a, so you think you can dance, and
right.
one of the shows is really popular. What's the other one?
Dancing
with the Stars. It's very much like that, but
right.
it's all students.
Right. Wow. The arts can be a great way
yes.
to get it.
Uh-huh.
I want to make sure we have time to get to everybody, so let's hear from this team.
Oh, sure. So I used to teach an urban sociology course, and so we discussed one of the assignments that I used to do in that class. And so I would break out my students into teams, and they would be assigned a neighborhood in Philadelphia. They would end up doing a 15-minute documentary on that neighborhood. And, it, you know, in terms of it being collaborative, and part of, I try to give them as much freedom as possible, but with pretty strong rubric. But I allowed them to figure out, like, where their individual strengths were. You know, everybody had the same access to the training, which was just the technical aspect of it. But, you know, some students were much more comfortable, you know, actually conducting the interviews. Others were more comfortable doing the research. Others were more comfortable editing. They all had to commit to spending a certain amount of time in the neighborhood. That was the biggest requirement for the assignment. But for the most part, you know, when it worked really well, partly because, you know, when they had the interviews, they couldn't just tell one story, right? So if it was a conflict perspective, they were looking at it through, and they were really looking at gentrification, they really had to look at the multiple actors that were, like, involved in what was going on in that neighborhood. They could talk to residents, they could talk to, let's say it's the University of Pennsylvania, you know, they could try and talk to someone from Penn, maybe some of the local businesses. And so it was really trying to understand overall what was happening in this neighborhood, in a much to get to the empathy piece of this, you know, to think about it from different perspectives.
I really like that. That's a great way to make the learning experience more experiential. And you could do it in a distance course by having students just go out in their neighborhoods and talk to people live, or even communicate with people online, either way.
Yeah.
But
and that's thinking, well, a different thing, because I'm thinking more like an oral history. I'm a history major, so I'm thinking more like that way. You also put Spanish, like for example, many stereotypes that I have in Spanish. It's not the same culture. That's what we're talking about, connection. Like many of students that have in the classroom, they say, oh yeah, because you're Latino. It's not a group. The group is humongous. Okay, so it's not the same. We don't like nachos. I don't like nachos, sorry. I like it, but not all the way. But so that's the stereotypes that we have. Like I see like a student. Many times we have that. So, like, I have an interview, have the interview and see different culture. You can apply for any class, too. You can apply also for Spanish history or anything.
Yeah, so, you know, that what you were saying just made me think, you know, so many communities, you may stereotype them in your mind as being one way, but in fact, they're so much more blended than we realize, and they're so, the identity goes so much deeper. Yeah, it's a really nice idea. I love that. Okay, how about folks over here?
Yeah, so we were talking about sort of two separate things. One is that we both work with student interns in some capacity, and so we were talking about thinking how to use like LMS spaces to get students to kind of have a cohort around their topics. And then, do you want to talk about your amazing idea?
Okay, I'm not sure if it's amazing, but so in my prior life, I taught in fully online coursework at the community college, and we were talking about QSort, so that was one of the activities we were exploring further, and I had explained that I taught a social justice and public policy course, so this all made a lot of sense, and trying to think about it in the fully online world, one of the kind of community building activities we started with was a set of pictures. So these students were likely to come from all over the state, maybe all over the Northeast. And they probably have never seen each other. There weren't necessarily pictures as part of the course of each other. And so I would post pictures of anything that were black and white, usually that four. And I would ask them to choose one in the discussion forum and describe it objectively. And we would start there with the descriptions and talk about what's objective in the description and what wasn't, and where the things that were not objective came from and what assumptions they might have made. And then what we talked about was the idea that I use that activity everywhere. It's very useful. And that would be a great kind of first step to the QSort as you're building the community, it would be a great place to kind of next. And when I saw that, I was like, that would kind of take it to the next level.
I really like that, and you can even combine it with the two truths and a lie that our keynote speaker was talking about earlier. Here are these pictures, tell us two truths and a lie, and sort of get at the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Very nice. Yeah, very creative. Thank you.
Sure.
Yeah, we're back.
So we also first didn't think about it being online. We thought about a physical resource only being available in a specific place so that students are like undoubtedly going to have to communicate with one another better to solve it. It's basically the only interesting thing we talked about.
Well, I really appreciate having the perspective of somebody who's not teaching. Mm-hmm. That's always very valuable, and that always helps us to get those insights. So thank you for that. And of course, that can change. You can become teachers, you know? It can happen, right?
Well.
So we are also in the position where neither of us teach online, so I think our conversation focused a little bit more on the collaborative elements, although I think both of us did have a technology component to them. But I think one of the common themes between our assignments was really thinking about how to engage students not just with one another within the course, but also with the public. So myself through a community-based learning project and through an annotation kind of tool that allows it to be kind of open to the public and not just be within the class. So really kind of thinking about engaging collaboratively, again, beyond our campus communities. And I think we kind of then used that to segue into a conversation about really how to help our students be more critical readers, as well as kind of collaborators and consumers of information.
Next workshop, right.
Yeah.
that's so important. But you're absolutely right, you know, that service learning or community-based learning can be so powerful. Thank you. What a wonderful range of ideas, things. So thank you very much for your many insightful comments and ideas. I'm going to go right on this down. I put my email up on the board. Would love to hear from you. If you have questions or you want to share things that you're doing, I'd love to hear from you. So thank you very much.